It's your boy Coast. I know it's been a while since we talked about some movies, but let's talk about Logan. So I've recently seen Logan, which is supposedly Hugh Jackman and Patrick Stewart's last rides as Wolverine and Professor X, respectively. But I gotta say, it's been one hell of a ride with both these guys on the bill as these characters. And as someone who's grown up watching X-Men, reading the X-Men, I have a whole stack of X-Men comic books from like 1995 when I used to collect them as a kid. So, I mean, I've been following it forever. And I remember waking up Saturday morning to watch the cartoon. So, I can honestly wholeheartedly say that I've been really satisfied with this movie franchise so far, with Hugh Jackman, Patrick Stewart, Ian McKellen. Just all these guys were just perfect for their roles. And it's sad to see them go, to be honest. They added something to the franchise that they added their own personal sort of touch to the franchise, and I just hate to see them depart from their roles. But they have lives. Hugh Jackman can't be Wolverine forever, and we understand that. So but it has been a fun run, and I've enjoyed every moment of it. So let's talk about Logan.
And it begins showing us that Logan is in a car. He's sleeping in a car, apparently, and he's getting robbed by some cholos. You know, he apparently is an Uber driver now. Times are generally hard for our mutant friend, and so he still kills thugs and stuff like that. But what I notice about this movie is that it portrays him as way more vulnerable. You can tell that he gets hurt and they're scarring instead of it completely healing over. So I thought that was an interesting concept to apply to this movie. Professor X and Caliban are living in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of this desert, at this old abandoned, what looks like an abandoned mining facility or something like that. Professor X is living in this water tech. And what was interesting to me is Professor X, his powers sort of are turned against him. He's no longer in control of his own power. His power controls him. Professor X is suffering from like dementia or something like that, or Alzheimer's. And you know, it's a really tragic situation to see such a beloved character in. Once a headmaster of a school, apparently he can't go anywhere now. Because anywhere near people, because his powers are threatening to everyone in the vicinity. He has these seizures that cause his telepathic abilities to go out of control, and you know he can mentally paralyze you when he's like having a seizure, or, like stroking out. You know, so that's another plot element that I thought was really interesting, but at the same time very depressing. So we're introduced to Wolverine, and he's driving his Uber and stuff like that. Caliban, who's also this mutant in the comics, he's a Morlock, which is this race of underground dwelling sewer mutants. And we see him in X-Men Apocalypse. We see him also taking care of Xavier, but apparently he's not doing that great of a job because he doesn't give him his sedations when Wolverine comes back. Yeah, Charles is having a seizure, and Wolverine has to go in and give him the medicine. Where it's really tragic. It's like it's like taking care of your parents when they're old and in the nursing home, or if they're old and frail, or old and infirm. You know, it's just really tragic. We see Professor X in this state, and he doesn't like it. You know, he's like, I'm in a tank. You know, I don't want to go out like this. You know, and he's afraid and very vulnerable, in a very vulnerable position. Whereas in other positions, in other movies, he would have been very much composed or at least in control somehow, or have a plan somehow. We don't see that here. Charles Xavier is very much about helping others, and in this movie, he can't even help himself. He's, in fact, a danger to others, and Wolverine is the one that has to take care of him. We're introduced to Laura in X-23. Brilliant character. I love X-23. She's, I think she's her own unique character. I mean, I don't like that they're that in the comics they're trying to make her, like, be Wolverine, you know, like, actually be that take on that mantle. I think just having the name X-23 suits her just fine. I mean, she already has her own identity. I'm not sure why they would want to give her Wolverine's identity. Well, I mean, I guess it sort of makes sense. I mean, she's made from his DNA, but at the same time, I don't know. I like characters to be their own characters, you know? Like, legacy characters to be, like, their own identity, like Nightwing. In some instances, he takes on the mantle of Batman, but he isn't Batman. No one could ever be Bruce, just like X-23 can never be Logan. But that's another story. What we see with X-23 is that she is being taken care of by this lady called Gabriella, I believe. We see this lady drive up to Wolverine at a funeral out of nowhere and beg him for help in shielding her from these guys that are hunting her. And the story sort of just takes off from there. We see Laura in the back of the car, just looking at Wolverine. It's very depressing. What I noticed thematically is that the desert sort of represents Wolverine's entire life right now. Like, just the state of his life. His life is like a barren wasteland, and he's afraid to come into contact with anyone. He's isolated. There are only two people in his life. One to help him take care of Professor X, and the professor himself, who is just like his father. The only remaining connection he has to the outside. He's afraid to come into contact with people because, as he states later on in the movie, he's afraid because he hurts people. He has nightmares where he hurts people, or he still feels responsible for a lot of deaths that have happened. And from all the hurt he's endured, and from all the hurt, whether directly or indirectly, he's inflicted upon other people, and that still traumatizes him, so he isolates himself. Now, a running theme in the movie is that mutants have been disappearing. There haven't been mutant births since 2004, and this movie takes place in 2029. And that is explained by, well, that is touched upon when we hear ads about, in the background, when Wolverine is driving, about super corn and how the government is treating food better. And, you know, by treating, they mean adding chemicals into the food, which people consume every day, like, you know, into the food and water supply that people consume every day. They're adding gene treatment as to eliminate mutants in the general populace before they even become a threat, you know, just to get them out of the way and suppress mutancy through everyday foods and food supplies and water. You know, mundane things that we take for granted. So we find that out much later, and we find out that that's also the reason why existing mutants have their powers severely crippled, have their powers, like, severely decreased. Existing mutants like Xavier and Wolverine, Wolverine's healing factor doesn't work as well as it should because, yeah, they have a ton of suppressants in every bit of food that they eat, in every bit of water that they drink. So it's kind of sad. And we also see you know, that the government is sort of like taking over the agricultural industry. Later on, Wolverine just so happens to save the Munson family, save them from this gang of government thugs, or corporate thugs. When they're in the cornfield in that scene, these giant mechs that are treating the corn with some kind of chemical to turn it into the advertised super core. And I guess they're trying to bully the Munsons off the property. So there is an interesting dichotomy between the little guy getting sort of crushed by these big powers like the government, corporations, and stuff like that, and going against them. And it also ties into the scene where X-23, Wolverine, and Professor Xavier, they have a discussion about family, about for each other, protects one another. So X-23 never really had a family, never really had connections, or lasting ones anyway. Because they told the caretaker Gabriella and the rest of the nurses at the facility to not treat them like children, but like all the birthday parties and all that, they all stopped. You see in one scene, one especially touching scene, where X-23 is with Wolverine and Professor X in a casino, and they see these two mannequins holding hands. One is obviously an adult, the other is a child, and she sees herself in the mannequin. She sees herself in Logan in the mannequin. And Professor X picks up on this and says, "Hey, maybe we should get a change of clothes." And then they watch a movie upstairs in their room, Casino's Hotel. And it's a movie called Shane, which is an old Western classic. And it's about a retired gunslinger. And they bond. They bond over that movie. Professor X tells her, like, "Hey, this is sort of what family is like. This is what it's like to connect with someone else, and to protect those you love." And it's an interesting scene because it's like a movie inside of a movie, and it's interesting when media references itself. And it was especially interesting to see the parallels between Logan and the character, the titular character in the movie Shane. Logan was in this movie very much like Shane. He was retired. He didn't want to fight anymore. He didn't want conflict, but conflict always seems to find him. He's like the last gunslinger, the last good guy. And Donald Pierce is the cyborg that shows up and wants Laura. Donald Pierce, the Reavers, and Dr. Rice, the guy who we find out later is responsible for Laura being X-23 and for having food treated to suppress mutant genes, who's sort of like the evil mastermind in all of this. He is sort of like the evil land baron in that movie, who sends out all of his hired thugs to go get the girl or get people off the property or to make them go away. So the parallels between that movie and this are very striking. And in that one sequence, the one sequence becomes so important thematically for the rest of the movie, and really just shows us that this is less of a superhero movie and more of a Western. But it's still a superhero movie set in the future, but it's also a Western. And an interesting thing is when Shane says, basically says, "Your morality is a brand. Good and evil are brands," or something like that. He says the choices you make are like a brand or something. Logan's brand, it's stuck, and people knew the kind of person that he was. Gabriella knew the kind of person that he was. That's why she went to him to take care of Laura, because she knew that he couldn't refuse helping people, no matter how angry or upset he was. I mean, even though he did refuse her, like, I think the first time, the emotion from the little girl that was playing Laura was just unbelievable. It was unreal, an unreal performance. You know, I have to tip my hat off to her. She was a phenomenal actress, and I felt like she did the character of X-23 justice. Feels though she was never really human until she met, until she progressed to the end of the movie, because they wanted to give her an essence of ferality, like, she was an animal. They wanted to make her entirely mute and only capable of, like, screams or growls or something primal like that. So Daphne Keene, tipped my hat off to her. She did a phenomenal job in portraying X-23. she could do all the moves. I mean, she was stabbing people and took out an entire group of trained mercenaries, trained cyborg mercenaries. Just really terrified the audience with her feral display. Having the two of them go on this journey was it was fun because, I mean, we got to see like 17 years of X-Men movies come to a close with this film. Tying into the theme of Wolverine being afraid to hurt people, you know, as he expresses later on, he said, you know, Laura says she has nightmares of people hurting her, and Logan says that he has nightmares of him hurting other people. I felt that was a good contrast. So the Munsons are the family that own the farm, which is next to the government super corn growing facility. When they help them out on the road, I mean, Logan is even afraid to give them a hand because he doesn't want these people to get involved or hurt. He doesn't want any extra baggage. He doesn't want these people to get killed because of him. Yeah, and he's afraid to even do the most basic heroic thing. But Professor X is never afraid to do the right thing. And die. Never gives up on his dream. He keeps hoping for a better future, and he can make it by just helping out one person, one family at a time. Then he'll take it. Even in his senility, his character remains the same. And so that's what I liked about this movie's portrayal of these two characters, and they're the same character, but, you know, they're out of sorts. They're in difficult straits. They're in a bad situation, worse than they've ever been in. And this movie pushes them to their limits and sees if they can still retain what makes them these essential characters. So Professor X and Logan, they help out this family. That's when the whole thing happens with the farm, and, you know, they go back. That's when they go back to the house, and they find out that we're fixing dinner, and Logan really wants to leave because he knows that these guys will probably catch up to them soon because they've captured Caliban and stuff like that. So he's like, "Yo, we should probably go," and then Xavier's like, "Nah, come on, bro. Like, at least have dinner." So they're like, okay, fine. So Laura is exposed to what it means to have a family in that moment. Daphne Keene is just an incredible actress. I mean, she's eating with her hands and stuff like that, and, you know, eat like an animal. And Logan and Professor X look at her like, yo. Like Logan especially, he realizes like, yo, this is my daughter, but I'm gonna give this kid, even he realizes, I'm gonna give this kid a piece of humanity. They all say grace and they're like, hey, this is what family is like. This is what it means to have togetherness, to belong to someone. And I thought that was really touching that Logan acknowledged Professor X as a father figure to him. That same scene. So overall, it's just a really powerful movie. It's an emotional movie because you know that these characters are going to meet their end. You just have that gut-wrenching feeling in the back of your mind, and it's just like, you know that, like, this is probably the last ride. You know, you see that old Western and you're like, yep, this is probably gonna be it. You know, you hear the rumors about Hugh Jackman not coming back, and you're like, yeah, but you still wonder, like, could this really be the end? Like, you know, how is it going to happen? And the Munson family is a nice family, but they're the kind of people that always get killed around Logan. I mean, you look at X-Men Origins, you know, some people say that movie was a terrible movie. I didn't think, it was all right. I mean, it was meh. Wasn't too bad, but you look at that movie, like that old Canadian family that got killed in Zero, got killed by him, and they didn't do it. They didn't do anything, and they got brutally killed. Phantom X, or Agent Zero, as he's called in the movie, he's like, "Yeah, nice people always seem to die around you." And I'm like, "Wow, this dude's a douchebag." just like, "Wow, this dude is the ultimate douchebag." And even though he was responsible, you know, he didn't have to kill the old couple. But nice people do seem to always die around him. And he's still afraid of that. And you still get the feeling like, yo, me personally, I was hoping that Logan could get out of there because I didn't want the family to get slaughtered somehow. Because I knew that something like that might happen. Yeah. And then they realize that the water supply isn't running, and yeah, the government goons that are sent out to stop them from, or to pester them and until they move from the facility, from the area, and give up their farm. And again, there's a striking parallel to the Western, of like these land barons sending out thugs to remove people from their property, even though it's theirs, and they can't really do anything about it. They can't really fight back against all these people, you know. And then someone like the Wolverine steps in, you know, the last real gunslinger, and comes in and saves his family from these people. And he just basically shuts them down and is like, "Yeah, get the hell out." He punks them, and they go back to their holes for a little bit. And then they go back home. We're introduced to a new character. Professor X is like apologizing. He thinks it's all his fault, the situation they're in. And it's really pitiful. He's talking to who we see as Logan. He's talking to him. And he's saying all this stuff, and then he gets stabbed right through the chest, and we realize that it's not Logan. It's just a sad scene, just to see Professor X like that, going out that way. It was just like wow, or just to see Professor X die like that. I mean, we saw him get disintegrated, but we knew like, hey, like maybe this guy could come back, and no coming back. There's not like some convenient like plot element, like his twin brother's body is gonna be just conveniently lying around for him to snatch or to take the place of. And we see him die on screen. It's just, you know, to get stabbed. I mean, he doesn't die right away, but you know it's a fatal wound because it's right in the heart. And it's creepy because this guy looks very similar to Wolverine. It's like a younger version of Wolverine. He's more muscular, and you know, he's more ferocious looking. He and X-23 get into a brutal fight, and he ultimately locks up X-23. And the Munson family kid, his mom, they go after X-24. We find out he's designated as X-24. He's essentially an inferior clone of Wolverine. He just slaughters the wife and kid, and they stood no chance, and Laura just had to watch. And so Logan and the Munson patriarch, they head into the house. They finally arrive, and they hear gunshots, and Logan runs up, sees this X-24 character, and it's like yin and yang meeting. It's like looking at an evil version of himself. The thing I liked about X-24 as a villain was that he embodied everything that Wolverine tried to fight against. He embodied everything that Wolverine wasn't. Even from everything from his clothing and attire to his attitude and character. Wolverine was in the light, you know, white shirt and, you know, the light jeans, and X-24 had the all black shirt and the dark, you know, dark clothing, dark pants, you know. And they're both staring each other down, and you know, X-24 has Laura. He has Laura in his hands, and he's just walking away with her, and he just looks at him and sizes him up, and you know, I guess he decides he wasn't a threat, but Wolverine is just like, who the hell is this? You know, just wondering, like, you know, maybe can I beat him? Like, I don't know. Like, is this a clone? Like, what is this? And it's interesting to see that. You know, it was just such a weird and freaky experience, even in the theater. You know, just to come face to face, just walk in and imagine you're coming face to face with yourself, with a younger, you know, healthier version of yourself. And the reason I say that X-24 embodies everything that Wolverine despised was that X-24 was sort of like, he's sort of like Sabretooth. In the comic books, the main thing that separates Wolverine and Sabretooth is that Wolverine doesn't want to be an animal. Wolverine doesn't want to be just another government puppet, just another mind control tool. He strives to be something more than just an animal, more than just a tool to be used. So I thought that was an interesting contrast in that scene. And I feel like X-24 embodied sort of that mindless animal. You know, he was just the perfect weapon. Everything that Logan would have been if he had somehow not escaped from the Weapon X program. He would have been just another programmed killing machine. And it's terrifying to think about it. You know, to actually see Wolverine's nightmares brought to life. Just Wolverine's nightmares embodied in this one guy. I mean, I think he's the ultimate villain for Wolverine. I mean, he's not even an intelligent being. He's just a rabid animal. Just something that Wolverine always strived to not be. And we see that embodied in X-24. In the first conflict between the two, we see Wolverine run up to Professor X and he takes him downstairs into the truck. X-24 runs into the same goons that Wolverine scared off, and he's like, hey, look, mister, like, you know, let's make a deal, okay? And he just cuts them up, kills them all mercilessly. And while that's happening, Professor X, you know, Wolverine's trying to cover up the wounds, and Professor X is like, the Sunseeker, you know, and he says the Sunseeker, and then he dies. The Sunseeker is another running theme. It's like this boat that he and Logan were saving up. He was driving his Uber around. It's this boat that he was saving up for in order to get out and retire in peace. And that was sort of their dream, just to get out and sail the waves. And that was his dream, and Professor X was still holding on to his dream. It was such his character to still hold on to dreams, even in the face of death, even in the face of all this bloodshed. You know, he's still holding on to some kind of hope, even at the end. And just the name itself, the Sunseeker. You know, you're sailing off into the sunset or riding off into the sunset. It sets a very iconic image in your head. You know? Just this peaceful, serene setting. It embodies every kind of hope that Professor Xavier has. And to see him die right there when he was expressing, you know, his desire to Wolverine, essentially just to not give up on the dream. It's really heartbreaking. And it especially reminds me of this speech given by Ted Kennedy. On how the hope still lives and the dream will never die. So even though he's gone, his dream still lives on and he's still chasing it. And he's still seeking it. I guess in that short phrase, the Sunseeker, he's telling Logan to not give up on being a hero and to still seek the dream, still hold on to the dream. And I thought that was an interesting theme to run along with. they talked about it in the beginning of how Wolverine was saving up for it. I thought that was an interesting thematic element. And of course, we see Wolverine get into it with X-24 after he's done killing off the thugs, corporate thugs. We see him tango with X-24. We see Caliban get revenge on his captors by, he says, "But where the light?" And he dies in the most epic fashion. Just blows himself up and like three other cyborg mercenaries, except Donald Pierce. Donald Pierce survives because he's the main character. A lot of people don't even know what Caliban means. Caliban is like this character from one of Shakespeare's plays, and he sort of dwells in the darkness and is like a shadowy kind of mutant figure. Even in the play, I mean, you can tell he's not natural. He's not normal. He's kind of like a monster that lurks around in darkness. And that plays well into his character. It says Caliban can't really go out into light. And Donald Pierce even makes fun of him, like he said, "Your mama probably told you to beware the light." And he gets revenge in that same fashion. Beware the light. Except he doesn't really kill Pierce. He just injures him a little bit. So Wolverine rescues X-23. And they head out. But we then see Dr. Rice, who was also there, was trying to calm X-24 down. But he was obviously failed at that. So we see him inject X-24 with some kind of serum that appears to boost his healing factor. Now, taking into consideration all the things that have been done so far, like, the government is clearly treating food with some kind of chemical. Rice has expressed his desire to monopolize mutants and to make his own weapons. He realized that the government is colluding with Rice in order to suppress mutants, to suppress the threat of random mutants happening in the world. And Rice is the only one that has the mutant power amplifier. It's that boosts your powers instead of just leaving you powerless. So he wants to have a monopoly on everything. He is also, him and the government and the corporations, they're all the land barons. He's the baron. So when drawing parallels to a Western or something like that, he's the corrupt corrupt. The thugs that he sends out, like the Reavers, are like the bought and paid for sheriffs. In the old Westerns that you would see, they're like the bought and paid for guys, the hired guns or something like that. And Rice is like the baron that pays them off. And he's like the evil mastermind behind everything. We get to where Logan and X-23 bury Professor Xavier in an unmarked grave, in a lush sort of forest on the side of the road. We realize that Logan is slowly dying from poison, and I thought that was also interesting to see him succumbing, his powers sort of taken from him. It was brilliant acting on the part of Hugh Jackman. I mean, just to see Logan still be Logan, still wanting to fight on, because he fights X-23 for control of the truck. Because he didn't want to give her the wheel. And we see him still fight, even though, to take the burden. He doesn't want X-23 to sort of take his burden. We see that X-23 is like, "It's okay, you can take a rest, take a breather. I've got this." And in that's sort of like a preview of what's to happen later on. Because X-23... she takes on the burden of Wolverine. She drives the car herself, and even later on in the movie, after all said and done, burden the torch is passed on to X-23. I thought that was a brilliant foreshadowing of what was to happen. X-23 would take the wheel, essentially, from Wolverine and carry on his legacy. I thought that was a good foreshadowing of what was to happen later on. And so the place they're trying to reach, they're trying to escape to, is Eden, and they have all these kids and stuff like that. Wolverine is scared that, you know, they might track them all there. They have all these other mutant kids that they experimented on, and none of their guardians or protectors survived. They had to make it there themselves. So Wolverine is sort of like caretaker temporarily for them. And Wolverine wakes up, and, you know, these kids are treating him, and they have the same green liquid that they were giving to, that Bryce was giving to X-24. And they use it on him, small doses, and they're like, yo, you don't want to overdose on this. So he's like, why not? You know, oh no. He goes like, yeah, it turns me into a raging killing machine. You know, I don't like this stuff. And so they say like it boosts your powers, and it neutralizes the stuff that's in everyday food products and stuff like that. It suppresses that chemical in order for your powers to work properly. And so we see the adamantium poisoning sort of wear off, you know, and his healing factor come back for a bit. So later on, after he and Laura had that talk, like, you know, where she dreams about people hurting her, and he tells her that, you know, he dreams about hurting other people. He sees that the kids are running through the forest, they're running away from someone, you know, and he goes all out. He goes after them. He goes after them, and he's wheezing and coughing and stuff like that, but he overdoses anyway. He goes on one final run. His last stand is a gunslinger, you know? And he kills, like, so many guys. Like, just, even the kids, like, they were amazing. The other kids, this one girl just destroyed this dude's arm. But yeah, he runs through that forest and just, no one survives. Runs through everybody, just kills everyone. You know, he's that's when the classic Wolverine returns, and we could see that. We see Bryce. I mean, Wolverine says earlier in the movie that he doesn't like guns. You know, and it's funny because gunslinging is kind of a theme in this movie, apparently. We see Bryce, and he's like, oh yes, like, you know, I wiped out the majority of mutants by putting stuff in your food. And, you know, he explains how there and why there have been no mutants born since 2004. And he says, oh yes, because you know, you killed my father when you broke out of the Weapon X facility, X-Men Apocalypse. So I'm gonna, you know, so I had this plan, this evil plan to suppress mutancy and to monopolize mutants so I can own your gen, because I grew you in a lab. I grew all these kids in a lab. I own them, essentially. Like, you know, they're my property, they're company property. I own their genetic code because, you know, hey, they essentially clone dead mutants, genetically modify their genetic code. Because I think I heard somewhere that if a company creates a life form or something like that, then they own them. Or if they create a certain genome that doesn't exist in nature, but they own the rights to that. So essentially his company owns, you know, claims they own these kids, and they own Laura. They're just taking back their property. So Wolverine, a person that doesn't use guns, is utterly disgusted by this, and in desperation he's surprised, pulls a gun and shoots him right in the head. I found that kind of surprising too, because I was just like, whoa, like, I've never, you know, you never see him use a pistol, you know. That's almost like a desperation move, and also like a, you know, screw you kind of move, you know, because he's just so disgusted with the guy, he doesn't even bother pulling the claws on him. The final fight with X-24 ensues, you know, Pierce unleashes him. The kids get revenge on Pierce, and they all kill him and gang up on him and kill him. But yeah, it's a brutal finishing match with X-24. After a while, you know, Wolverine is clearly like not doing so well, and he's being dragged by X-24, like, you know, like a cow that's being led to the slaughter or something like that. And he gets impaled by, you know, much in the same way that X-24 did, on a fallen tree limb. You know, he just gets it shoved like right into his back. He's about to die. He's laying there dying. And X-24 is just beating the crap out of him. And we see Laura pick up a gun, and she has like the adamantium bullet that Wolverine saved to kill himself with. And she shoots him right in the head. His entire brain just goes everywhere. Like, and Wolverine is like, so this is what it feels like. And you know, he's about to die. You can tell it's just like, dang, yo, like about to die. And the theater got really, really quiet, and everyone was just like in shock, like, this is actually happening. We're seeing the death of Wolverine, someone that no one thought could ever be killed. You know, so this is how it ends, and we were all very surprised at what happened, or how it happened. I was surprised. I thought it was going to be like, okay, well, you know, he's just going to come back from that. And he didn't. And then it was official, like, Wolverine is dead. It was ironic that he died in a place much, much different from where he was living out, but where he tended to live out the rest of his days. You know, he was living in isolation, middle of the desert. And there was nothing green around him. It was like no life around him. And he dies in a forest. I felt like the forest was a nice contrast to that arid, dusty area that he started in. So just visually, I thought that was a nice contrast. Young Mutants, they all bury him. And X-23, she recites a line she heard from Shane, from the movie Shane. How there are no more guns in the valley, and it's okay now, little Joey. That was her eulogy. She recited that word for word, and she paid her respects. They laid a cross at his grave. And Laura, you know, when all the mutants were about to leave, you know, she turns it over so that it's an X. You know, it was just sort of like a final RIP. I thought Wolverine's death was very biblical. I thought it took on sort of an Old Testament kind of going out and saving the younger generation, or leading them to a promised land. I thought it was almost like Moses leads the Israelites to promised land that God had promised for them and set aside for them. He leads them to this location. He gets them to the gate, you know, right to the border, and then the next generation makes it, but he himself does not make it. And I thought that was very much like Moses. Died before, you know, he died without ever setting foot in the promised land. And I thought that was just the parallels that, between that and the final scene in Logan. Just very striking. I mean, to see Logan sort of like come that close to seeing the dream, to finally reaching the sun, and then passing off that quest to a new generation. You know, I thought that was a nice little passing of the torch. And the younger generation, I guess, will continue the fight in their stead, I guess. They're in Canada now, doing whatever, I mean. But the nice cut to black and then no after credit scene, like, that's so typical of Marvel movies. Yeah, it ends like a typical Western, instead of a superhero movie. I thought that was really nice. I mean, going with the whole Western, it's just overall such an amazing, emotional movie. I mean, it gets you every time. I mean, there are so many emotions in the movie, like
rage, love, joy, and anger, you know, justice, righteous anger, you know, and it's just like, it's just a phenomenal way to send out this guy as Hugh Jackman, as Wolverine, and to set up X-23 as her own independent character in the future of the X-Men franchise. And if that's meant to be chronologically the last X-Men movie, then I'm satisfied with it. I mean, but I just want to see Mr. Sinister on screen at least once. You know, I want to see Mr. Sinister, Cable, and Deadpool, and, you know, just any one of those guys together. If they make an X-Force movie, that would be totally awesome. I would definitely be down to see it. New Mutants or something like that, that would be cool. You know, just something along those lines. But Logan is definitely artistically great. It's visually great, and just narrative wise, it's a superior superhero movie. It's almost akin to Dark Knight Returns series, and I feel like him going on this last run, this last journey as Wolverine, go out firing and protecting the dream that Professor X saw, you know, as embodied in these children, protecting that and everything he stood for, just one scene. I thought that was just epic. If you haven't seen Logan yet, go see it. And I highly recommend it. One of the best superhero movies I've ever seen. Well done. Just well done. That's all I gotta say. I give this movie a 10 out of 10. And I rarely do that for any movie, but when you consider all the other X-Men movies, if you've seen them, I feel like seeing all the other X-Men movies would definitely give this movie a higher emotional yield. It'll definitely give you more of a clue as to what's going on, as to the conflict in the stories. And if you haven't gotten into the X-Men universe, I suggest you pick up on some of the old comic books if they sell the paperbacks, or, you know, just go to your local comic store and read up on some X-Men, or just read a wiki or something like that. But I would suggest you catch up on the movies, find out what, you know, just a little bit of the backstory before you delve into this movie, because this movie is a superior movie. I mean, I wouldn't recommend it if it wasn't. People complain about Fox all they want, but I'm just happy that they could pull off such a masterpiece. Still have the rights. I mean, Disney is whining all they can about, you know, not having the rights. They can keep whining. I mean, I love what Fox has been doing so far with the X-Men franchise, and I want them to continue. This is your boy Kos, signing off.